Let's start this panel. There's a little Dracula joke here, so. Can the audience all say this on a count of three in your best Dracula voice? Ready? One, two, three. That's really good. Scariest Dracula of all time, the Count from Sesame Street. Okay, I am Hugh Ryan Brown. That is not actually me. That is my nephew, Byron. And I know he's the coolest vampire I've ever met. So I wanted to show him off just a little bit here. I think he might actually grow up to be a vampire. That picture's a little too good. And we have a bunch of guests, which are gonna come up pretty soon. But first, let me tell you about Castlevania Season 2, Blu-ray and DVD. It is coming very soon, so pre-order that now. It has lots of extras like production, stills, and animatics, and all kinds of cool stuff. So pick that up when it comes out and display it proudly on your shelf of cool stuff. Also, you have one more day. Today's Saturday, right? Yes, you have one more day to come by the VIZ booth and get your Castlevania poster, so please come pick this up. And when you leave, it's double-sided. When you leave, there are lenticular coasters in the back for you, so make sure you grab a Castlevania coaster. We're giving you posters and coasters. It's lenticular. And now, I would like to bring up the first guest, the voice of Isaac, Ade McCormick, will you please come on stage? Why don't you have a seat and say hello.
Hello, everybody. You having a good time? Yes. Awesome.
It's about to get better because we're also introducing Alejandra Reynoso! Do you want to do some cool magical arm movements? You've been practicing, haven't you?
I haven't, clearly. Hello, everyone. Oh, my God. I don't know where to put this.
And next, the lovely James Callis Alucard. And also stylish. He always looks so stylish, exactly like his character.
It's just cold, in fact.
Well, you are like half vampire, so your blood is like, you know.
Right.
I see.
That's right.
Okay, and next, put your hands together for Graham McTavish, woo! The voice of Dracula.
Hello, hello. Nice to see you all. You're all looking marvelous. Well, the ones that I can see, which is only the front row, actually. But anyway, you look great. Thanks for coming. Oh, thank you. I love you too.
Okay, and the hits keep coming with Sam Dietz, the director of this fine show. Nice shirt, bro. Why don't you give a little flex for the ladies? Flexing. There we go. And the men, too.
Howdy.
And you're missing one member of your beloved family. And he loves his brother. He really does. They've been talking back and forth. We've been going out. And you just love your brother. And I think that's so sweet.
I do.
So let's bring him out. Adam Dietz. Woo! Who used to win the fights?
Ayo. It was him, but I'm pretty sure I got him now.
There's only one way to find this out.
Maybe like Smash Brothers, because I do beat him at Smash Brothers.
This is absolute bullshit. That's not real.
Sonic, unfortunately.
Okay.
I see the problem.
And finally, the brilliant and demented mind that brought you this incredible show. Please put your hands together for Warren Ellis. Woo!
Was there nothing else to go to tonight? Well, I don't want to know about your personal life.
This looks like you're actually in Castlevania, your photo here.
Yeah, that was actually shot in a special effects facility outside London, where, amongst other things, they have a working Victorian mortuary. That they use for horror film shoots. But I really kind of wanted it to be my living room.
All right, since we have these lovely people here from all over the globe, let's ask them about this incredible show right after this trailer to give you a taste. Lights down, please.
No further. My generals, in killing my wife,
please!
Humanity has proven to me that they don't deserve the Earth. We will scour them off the land. My father, he's gone mad. And now he's going to destroy the world. Human scheme and betray. They all must die. Imagine it. A world without humans. Under endless night.
My God.
Dracula has to be destroyed. We can't fail.
Stand back.
We're all gonna die! All of us!
Enough!
Fuck.
Ooh. Oh, yeah, that's... Sorry. Woo! That's a surprise ending. That happens sometimes. Okay, and now we would like to give you a very special message that everybody wants to say at the same time. But before they do, I want them to put on a pair of vampire teeth.
Oh, crap.
1, 2, 3, 4 times. Okay, perfect. I'm not gonna ask Warren to do it because I know his answer.
Be a team player, Warren.
Come on, Warren.
No, there's actually not enough
teeth. Come on.
He can't. He's only 16. He has real vampire teeth, so he doesn't even need this.
Yeah.
No.
I'm sorry.
We had this conversation yesterday, and he knows full well he'll be found face down in the Bowery tomorrow morning.
I don't want to die, so I'm not going to make him do it. Okay, everybody, you know, as an actor, diction is important. Everybody got their teeth in? Okay, as an actor, diction is very important. So please try to enunciate all these words very carefully. And we're gonna put it right now. Here we go. Here is the special message. Can we just show the slide really fast so the audience can see the message and we'll go back to the actors? Ready? On three. 1, 2, 3. Can you guys keep your teeth in for one more second? Can we get a shot of the whole group?
Oh.
All right, show them your teeth. Show them your beautiful teeth.
Oh, I already took them out.
Put them in and bear them.
Arr. You want to put them back in again?
Yeah, one more time. Sorry. All right, scary Dracula faces.
You are history's greatest monster.
How about a big round of applause for these wonderful actors for incredible acting. All right, and now on to the actual
interview. Throw
them
into the audience. Throw the used teeth in.
That seems unfair.
I'm not going to do that to them, I'm sorry.
No. I don't want those to end up on eBay or something.
No, does anybody want the teeth when they're done? No?
You don't.
I know what the people want.
All right, first question. This is one of, if not the best video game adaptations of all time. Do you guys agree? Yeah! Why do you think this show succeeded where many others have not, like Mario Brothers movie or something? Like, what did you guys do right?
You're gonna have to start on the other end.
Okay, start over there at the very end with Ade.
I think it's because the characters are so fleshed out. And they have such heart, and they're so well written. Warren, you're brilliant. Seriously, it's a pleasure to go to work and say your words, and I love doing it. And just it's superbly directed, and I've got an incredible cast and crew that I get to work with. So I think, in my opinion, that's why the show works.
I think it's worked because it's so evident how much the creators behind it, how much they love and respect the property and the story and the characters. And first and foremost, it is about making a great story with great characters that are fleshed out and they're all well-rounded, complex individuals. So it wasn't about making a video game adaptation and it wasn't a cash grab for anyone. It was a project that was really important to the people who did it. I know Sam and Adam, you guys were huge fans of the games and loved it so much. And Warren, I mean, Ade already said it, but getting to go into the booth every day and live in that world and play in this world that you created, there was no way it wasn't going to be as great as it ended up being.
He's blushing. Next, James.
Yeah, what she said. I mean, really, there's... every time I see that trailer, by the way, it's like, it just... It's right. So exciting, and it's so dark, and it's kind of, for me, it's interesting that something that is anime can be so truly scary, so really worrying, disturbing, I would say, which I think then makes it important in some, we're chronicling something, there's some... No pun intended, but like some like real meat on the bones.
That's a good pun. I mean.
And because I suppose we've all taken it so seriously, and the jeopardy stakes are so high, and it's not just about these. As you can see, it's not just about the characters who are in the show. It's about society, and about the ripping apart of that society. So it's pretty serious stuff. And it's very exciting to be a part of it.
Good answer.
Yeah, I would definitely concur with all of that. Everybody involved in this has shown a great deal of passion for the project, and that really comes across, I think, in all the sessions that I did. Everybody was pushing with the same purpose, which was to make the best possible series that we could, and it's a show of moral complexity, which I think is really interesting. Big kind of universal themes. I mean, it has this wonderful kind of horror, gory, violent backdrop, but actually the issues it deals with, family, love, loyalty, religion. I mean, they're big themes, and I think that's what sets it apart, really.
Well, they stole all my answers, but what I would like to add to that is that I think that there was a very lovely, obviously everyone contributing to the project is coming from very different viewpoints and backgrounds, and those things worked so well together harmoniously. Warren walked in not really knowing the games, but did... I think an exceptional level of research into the property. I've consistently blown away by what I find that he's actually looked into is obscure things that even me and Adam didn't know about. And so he, even though he hasn't played the games, he's made that effort to actually do that research and find the things that in the original story that work for this type of storytelling, and then not being so beholden to them that it forces us to tell, you know, a story that couldn't be as good as it could be. And that way, you know, we come from the angle of like making sure that the look of it and the art and animation feels like something that is rooted and in the what you expect from that game world. But storytelling, it can go in directions and be handled in a way that is best for engaging the audience and just hitting you emotionally.
That was a good answer, Sam. That was it. That was from the heart.
Yeah, Sam said it earlier today, which was that we didn't set out to make the best video game adaption necessarily. We set out to do a good show. You know, our influences on the show are things that are rooted in, you know, film and animation. And, you know, we both love the games. We played them most of our lives. I've played every game in the series. I even wrote a couple strategy guides on the games. And that's meaningful and it matters, but it's not as meaningful as wanting to just to do a really good piece of art, a good piece of media, and to make sure that what Warren is doing and saying in the text comes through visually.
All right.
Well, my answer's in two parts, but I'm going to make it quick. The first part is I can't answer the question as it's presented because I've never seen any other video game adaptations. I don't get out much. I really don't. But what I do want to talk about is the root of the whole thing, which I think is actually what answers the question. And it all started with Kevin Coldy, my co-producer, our showrunner, the guy who holds the show together on a daily, if not hourly, basis. 364 days a year. I know you're watching this live stream, you tyrannical bastard. And it all started with him. He came to me, he said, I want to make Castlevania into, we were talking about a film originally, and he said, I don't want it to be an adaptation per se. I want it to be something that takes the material and becomes its own thing. So everything I've done, and after me, everything everyone else has done has all come from that. It's all come from Kevin Coldy's inception of the project and his unerring creative instinct. So if you're watching, Kevin, thank you.
That's beautiful. Thank you, Kevin.
Thank you.
All right, next question. What was your favorite scene in the entire show? And we'll start at the very end with Ade.
Oh, goodness. I think towards the end where I'm thrown out to the Oasis and I get to be such a badass and I love that scene. I think you really see, well, so many different things. First of all, how Isaac stands up against oppression, which I think also reflects racism and him just saying, you know, enough's enough and I'm going to do something about it. And you get to see him just be just an incredible person. So yeah, that's my favorite scene.
All right, next.
I'm split. There's a particular action sequence with some really great music that...
Hell yeah.
That was great. But as far as... a sci-fi scene that really stuck with me, it's right at the end. It's really Graham and James, Alucard and Dracula having their final moments, and he comes to that realization and he says, my boy, I'm killing my boy. That probably is the thing that stuck with me the most.
We're assuming you've seen it, by the way.
I'm sorry.
Spoiler alert.
I know, spoilers.
I think the whole thing is so incredible, really. I don't think I have a favorite scene. I just realized how much I want to watch it again, having just seen that, the tease. I can't, I think as well, the thing I possibly didn't say before, but it's so beautiful to look at. This artwork, this animation, it's the top of any game, certainly of anything I've ever seen. Just looking at this picture right now, it's so arresting. No words, lost.
Good answer, beautiful. Next.
Well, I have to say actually that I really did enjoy that last scene that I had with James. It was, as a parent myself, you know, that feeling of sacrifice, the sacrifice that you would make for your own child, spoke very much to me. And also it was an opportunity, I think, for, I guess, Dracula to redeem himself, really, and to rediscover the humanity that he found at the beginning of the story, my story. So that really sticks out for me. It was a very powerful moment to do that, yeah.
Sam?
I am going to have to say that very last sequence of the last episode of season two, where James did an absolutely fantastic job actually bringing himself to tears in the recording booth in order to deliver that final moment of the season. Which made me cry and made everyone else that's ever touched that sequence cry. It's a really beautiful moment. And I also just wanted to give a little shout out to Kevin Coldy, because that last sequence, we went over the music a dozen different times, and he made that final call to play most of it completely silent. At first I was like, I'm not sure, is this the best way to do it? And then I listened to it a few more times and I was like, oh, this is crushing. And that was just a brilliant, brilliant call.
All right.
Yeah, I think that last sequence of episode is my favorite. And I'm really proud of it, because I got to work on it a little bit on my own, lonesome. And shout outs to Amanda Sture, who also boarded that sequence. She did an amazing job. She really set the tone for the thing. And I can't thank her enough for it. I do, however, it's kind of hard, because that bloody tears fight, you know? It's pretty dang solid. And I've wanted to get that music in there for a very long time. But no, it's got to be the end of episode 8.
Thing is, you can't ask a writer that question. Because immediately you go to, well, let me tell you about all the times I was brilliant. But... yeah, very good. One of the things that's always stuck in my head about season two, and it speaks a lot to the way we work on the show, and our amazing cast. Jamie Murray as Carmilla beating up Theo James as Hector. Working with our fantastic casting director and voice director, Meredith Lane. We took a few passes at it. And then as Jamie, and she was physically acting this out in the booth, as I recall, just, you know, jabbing Theo's eyes out and squeezing his nuts and what have you. She starts giggling as she does it. And it was just the funniest, creepiest thing. And to this day, whenever I think about it, it makes me smile and also chills my blood. And also makes me cross my legs.
Okay. All right. Next question. I have played the game, this is to Warren. I have played the game the series is based on, Castlevania 3, Dracula's Curse, and there are like 5 lines of dialogue in the whole thing. How in the heck did you spin it out into such a rich story?
Well, I mean, you know my secret. I imagine most of the people in this room know my secret by now. I never played the games. None of them. I mean, those things started coming out in the 80s. In the 80s, I was living in a rented room that was literally a converted dark room. It was 6 foot by 6 foot. I was lucky I had electricity. By which I mean literally one single uncovered light bulb on the ceiling. I was born in the wrong era to be a gamer, in large part. So I haven't seen the games. I took the job when Kevin originally talked to me about this. I said, that sounds wonderful. I'd love to do it. He said, you know, looking at the pile of bills on the table. I'd love to do that. And then hung up and said, what the is Castlevania? But what I discovered is not only is Wikipedia really very well stocked on Castlevania lore, but also there is a vast community of people who, judging by the web pages since the dawn of the World Wide Web, have been creating fan pages about the show. And just getting down as much of the lore, the detail, the background as they possibly could as an act of love for the game series. So in large part, this show does exist because of that impassioned fan community.
Wow, thank you. All right, next question. Mr. Dietz, Sam Dietz, how do you even direct a cartoon? Do you just stand around yelling at cartoon characters? Like, what do you even do?
On the worst days, he does.
No, he cries at them.
It would be really nice if it were that simple. It's very different from live action in that so much of it comes down to sitting down and drawing. You get together in rooms with other artists, you explain how things should be playing out, you explain the feeling around things, and you do notes and pass things around and review stuff and all that, but it all comes down to me to the drawing. Every character from season one and most of season two, I was very hands-on with designing all of those characters and the general art style and look of the show. And every time there's a sequence of storyboards, and the storyboards are really like the blueprint of directing television animation, because those board drawings are translated almost directly to the final frame. In many cases, they're literally traced. And so when I'm reviewing anything, storyboards or animatics or et cetera, I'm very hands-on with those things. And it just comes down to sitting down and drawing the heck out of stuff. And I'm very fortunate to have an incredible team of people that are just as passionate as I am and want to make the best damn thing that they can. And they're probably working right this second, making, animating things and doing absolutely beautiful work. And I cannot thank them enough.
Impassioned. I mean, I remember, I think on 2 separate occasions I've tried to stage an intervention with you to make you go the home.
I work from home a lot, but I am still working.
All right, good answer. And for the next person, which is Mr. Adam Dietz, how did you get involved in the project and what's it been like working on this?
Well, when the project first came to Powerhouse, Sam and Kevin Coldy and crew were the ones that originally did the first pitch. But amusingly enough, Brad does this thing every week called the 400, where he talks about the projects that are going on around the studio. And just sort of nonchalantly one day, he's just like, oh yeah, this Castlevania thing might come in. And I audibly gasped loudly, like, and everybody turns and looks at me real awkward, like. And after that, I go up to Sam and I'm like, we have to get that. We have to get that. And so, you know, long story short, they pitched it. They got the job. And I had been working as a supervising post-production director for a while. And I've done a lot of anime-style trailers and work for the studio, like the Duelist trailer and a bunch of other stuff that we've done. And it was a natural fit for me to kind of move over to assistant director, just because I've done editing on that end before, and I've done a lot of post-production work. And that's kind of my role, is that I kind of dual-wield managing the editing passes on things, putting in temp music, making sure the timing works and feels right artistically, making sure it's selling all the tone of every scene, and then putting the final polish on it, the finishing touches. And yeah, that's how.
Adam basically takes on a whole bunch of the stuff that I frequently run out of time to do because I keep going off into a dark corner and drawing.
Actually, my goal a lot of time is definitely to keep Sam drawing because he's kind of the heart of the visual end of the show. And so if he's not doing that, it's a mistake.
That's what a brother's
for.
That's
very nice. And
helping
now
out.
Now I feel bad.
Okay, so Graham, how do you go about giving life to the lines of a character that's dead inside? No pun intended.
Wow. Dead inside. No. Well, he's not, you see. That's the interesting thing about Dracula, is that he's not dead inside. He's very much alive, despite, you know, appearances to the contrary, perhaps. He feels emotion, and that's what I think is so interesting about this particular interpretation of the Dracula story. I mean, when I watched Christopher Lee... Yes. An absolutely fantastic Dracula. When I watched that, you weren't struck by the level of emotional complexity in Dracula or his sort of moral contradictions. He was just a very, very scary guy in that. And hopefully, you know, I'm a scary guy too in it. But I just find the heart of it is his love. And his what she ignites in him that had lain dormant suddenly comes to life, and that's what precipitates the rest of his story, because he, you know, he can't bear the thought of what's happened to her and all the vengeance, and then finally at the end with James and all the rest of it, that love comes back. And so I am not dead inside. Thank you.
All right, good answer. All right, James, Alucard is exceptionally cool and handsome. Did you find it easy to play a character like that?
Did I find it easy to play a character like that? The real honest answer is no. I don't think it was easy. It was a total change around for me. And I think that we touched on this before, that Alucard comes across as remote and dispassionate. I did a few recordings where, I don't know, in the recording started raising my voice, and that just sounded all wrong for the character. It just felt like if you are very powerful and kind of ice cool, then you really keep your temper. So then it was how to play this guy with, because he doesn't want to give very much away. But while you're still not trying to give very much away, revealing your inner nature. I mean, the fact that he looks amazing is just very exciting. Just, I wish I looked like that, but I don't. There it is.
We could probably get you a wig. Okay.
Thank you.
Alejandra, what did you think of Saifa as a character? Did you feel a connection to her?
I mean, she's such a fun character to play, and I've mentioned this before, but she's the first character that I've felt such a strong connection to, because I feel like she's been the character that I've put the most of myself into. And I've mentioned that Warren and Meredith and Kevin all gave me a great deal of agency when we were finding her and creating her. And that was such a gift as an actor to be able to do that. So I definitely feel a connection to her. I think I've grown a lot as an actor being able to do this, because I do feel like I take a lot more responsibility for my choices now artistically, and I feel like I have that agency, and that's been a huge thing for me.
Cool. All right. Next question. Oh, prize break. Okay. We're going to give these posters away. They are signed by every member of the cast. So, yeah, don't shout out the answer. Raise your hand, and I will choose you, okay? And then I'll make sure I identify you and then stand up and you can answer. And someone out there, David Brothers, will you stand up? He's going to actually give you the poster. First question, raise your hand if you know. What is Dracula's favorite drink? I saw the guy in the orange, and is it orange and white? You have a water bottle. Stand up. Yeah, stand up. Yes, that's correct.
Well done.
It's actually, well done. Well done.
Nice.
It's actually a Blood Light. Okay, I'm moving on. Okay, Ade, Isaac is literally my favorite character in the entire show. Do you feel any pressure knowing that?
Now, yes. Goodness. Yeah, thank you.
what did you think of his character?
So elaborate, okay. I love Isaac. It's interesting to have a character portrayed in such a way that during that time period, he is smart, he's complex, he is passionate, and he's a hero. And I remember thinking when I was younger, I didn't have characters like this to look up to. I had always prayed I would have a black character that I could say, oh goodness, that's my hero. I had the Spider-Mans and the Supermans, but I didn't have someone who looked like me. So, you know, representation truly, truly does matter. And I want to thank these people. So thank you guys, Warren, Sam, Adam, for letting me play this character and inspiring so many other people as well.
That is beautiful. Okay, we have about 20 minutes left on the panel, and I don't know how it's going so fast, so we'll have to probably make our answers just a tiny bit briefer. So we can get all these questions done.
Okay.
And watch something very special that is going to blow your mind. That is coming up. Group, very quickly, the legends of vampires are very old, but they're more popular than ever. Why do you think humans are so obsessed with this comment? And we'll start at the end. This concept. Why do people like vampires so much? Forever. Ade.
Oh, because they're cool and they're superheroes. I think that's why.
Okay, yeah, that's good. Alejandra?
I mean, you get to explore a lot of the darkness, I guess, that lives in people. I mean, it was a human creation. You wanted to find something scary and the things that go bump in the night. But, I mean, these stories date back so far, and there's all this great old Russian folklore of all of these monsters that eventually turned into vampires as well. So I'm going to pass it over because I know that Warren has a really good answer at the end.
Okay. Why do people like vampires?
Eternal youth.
That's a good answer. All right, Graham, why do people like you?
Eternal life.
Quickly, this time.
They have great rare drops.
Okay.
I like that.
Okay.
It's because they're hot.
Okay.
They're pretty hot.
I could give you the intellectual answer, but basically they're hot and they kill people.
All right, that was fast and perfect. Next. Warren, you're no stranger to animation. Anime, what do you enjoy about working in this medium?
And I've got to make this quick, yes. In comics, I always say the comics are the visual narrative that have the fewest filters between me and the artist and you, the readers. Not like in live-action television or in film, where there are hundreds, if not thousands, of people between me and you. In adult-oriented animation, because in English is relatively new territory and it's kind of the Wild West in a lot of ways, we haven't accreted that many filters so that when we speak, we can speak directly to you without anyone else in the way. And that's what I love about working in this medium.
It's perfect. Okay. And we're going to show you a clip really quick about a fight scene. So lights down, please, lights down. House lights down, please. The power of Dracula commands you.
Oh, there it is.
I terrify them. Cypher disorients them. Alucard goes over the top and we support him.
Yes.
Begin.
Okay, quickly, Sam Dietz, we only have 15 minutes left, and we have to get to the clip. Once we get to the clip, then we can slow down. All right, these fight scenes are incredibly intricate, and part of what makes the show so cool and compelling. Can you go into the creation a little bit?
Oh, crap.
Come on, you can do it. I know you can do it.
They're really hard. generally speaking, what we do is we first establish what are the abilities that everyone in the room has and what is the setup in the room. In the case of the room in this fight in 207, the room was pretty open, so it was basically a big old battle arena for them to run around in. So we established what kinds of abilities we wanted to see our heroes contesting with, and what would be an interesting set of events to play out. And then honestly, a lot of it is just trying out a few things, thinking of clever things that they can do. One of the things that I always try to put into action scenes is finding a way that the hero defeats whatever they're fighting, not just through brute strength, but by being a bit clever.
Clever. That's the way to do it. Outthink your opponent. Okay, next, Adam Dietz. Quickly, you work on the special effects on the show. Can you tell us what goes into that?
We've developed a very particular pipeline that allows us to key out the color, individual colors on a character, and put gradients and bevels and textures on things. And it gives a nice roundness to all the characters. We have heavy color grade passes, and we do a lot of particle work and special effects. And I even animate special effects by hand myself. And so the nuances of that all together with like a really strong animation team on top of a great compositing team, you know, every single scene is touched by us. And it doesn't, there's no scene that comes back from our partner in Korea, Tiger, that we don't do some level of work on.
And it shows, too. It is a gorgeous show. Graham, you often play bloody tough guys, broody tough guys. Do you ever dream of playing My Little Pony, a Smurf, or something silly?
Graham McTavish, Death Smurf.
Yeah, I mean, exactly, just incredibly violent Papa Smurf. You know, the saint of killer ponies, you know, that kind of thing. I mean, I just it just seems to be what I've been given. I mean, I would like to play more comedy and, you know, romance, but nobody seems to want me to do it.
Sorry about that. All right, James, quickly, Alucard is very cool and detached. Is it tough to voice a character without coming off as uninterested?
I think we kind of covered that before, so... Yes, it is.
Okay, perfect. Okay. Alejandro, Cephid has a lot of complicated arm movements that cast spells in the show. Do you do that in the voice acting booth, too?
No. I mean, it's a lot of just big gestures. We hadn't established any of the hand motions when I first got in the booth and started doing that. That came later. So it was a lot of just general, like, hah! Like, just really big hand motions.
Perfect. Okay, and Ade, is it hard to feel a connection to a character that's evil or commits active evil versus someone good?
No, because you're both
feel like what you're doing is just and the right thing. So I just play my commitment to doing something I believe is right. And yeah.
Okay. Isaac would just thought that was right, you know? Mm-hmm. The right choices. Okay, really quickly, what is one of your favorite horror movies, all the way down from Ade? Quickly.
Gosh, I'm not a horror fan at all. I hate it.
Okay, Alejandra.
Same. I can't even watch the trailers.
Okay, James.
No, I am not a horror film fan, but my favorite, I think my favorite horror film is The Shining, possibly. Oh,
nice. All right, Graham.
Yeah, The Shining's a really good one. The Wicker Man is an amazing, if nobody's ever seen it, the original Wicker Man is pretty outstanding. And I don't know if it falls into the horror genre exactly, but the original version of The Vanishing, the Dutch version, does that count as a horror movie?
Sure.
Terrified the bejesus out of me. I mean, okay. That was really, yeah.
Sam.
I it turns out I'm a big baby when it comes to horror stuff. I get scared super easily, and my wife likes to make me watch lots of horror stuff to watch me get scared. So
squirm.
I don't know if I would have a favorite.
Okay, Adam.
Alien.
Nice.
Okay,
it's
yeah,
gonna be
that.
The good one.
Oh God, pick one at random. Videodrome.
Nice.
Hell yeah.
The New Flesh. Okay, prize break really fast for this poster. Answer this question if you know. What kind of house does Dracula live in? Okay, the guy in the front with the shirt, and it's a white shirt, you're pointing yourself, stand up. Yep, you. No, you have long hair. You. Yes, sir, give him a poster, moving on. Okay, Warren, you write novels, comic books, and in Castlevania's case, a screenwriter. Do you approach each differently, briefly?
Not only do I approach each differently, I approach every single job differently. Every piece of work has a different entryway into it. I mean, if any of you are writers, and you think the way to do it is you start on the first line of chapter one and just go sequentially through all the way to the end, forget it, you'll die. Start where it feels right. If that means starting at the end, do it. Start in the middle, whatever. I was upstairs with William Gibson earlier. Yeah? And I know for a fact he started one novel where he just had an image in his head of a container being loaded off the ship. So he wrote that image down and just kept writing, and that turned into a novel. You go in any way you can.
Nice. What, was that dog your idea?
Hmm?
It was a dog your idea?
The disgusting little zombie dog. Yes, that was me.
I love that dog. Okay, quickly, Graham, is it difficult to play a character that's so full of sorrow? Does it affect you as an actor?
Well, no. Seriously, actually, no. I don't get affected like that. You know, I've played all sorts of different characters, and if I play the sorrow, I leave it behind. Yeah, I don't carry it around with me at all. Fortunately for everyone in my life, because that would be really awful.
Okay, and quickly, I'm wondering why did I put so many questions in this panel? Learning experience. James, what do you think Alucard really thought about his father?
Whoa. Graham and I were discussing this today in another interview. So I think what he feels is he doesn't feel that his father is bad or evil. He knows his father is a learned, brilliant doctor. It's tragic circumstances that have brought them to fight. But as we were saying today, how does he feel about it? He understands that Dracula allows Alucard to kill him. In the sense of, we've been talking about, you know, did you kill your dad? I don't think that Alucard is powerful enough. He's not powerful enough. And it's the realization when Dracula has that he's about to kill me that suddenly makes him vulnerable and allows Alucard to kill him, which is why it's so brilliant and so tragic.
It is. It's quite beautiful.
Absolutely.
Okay, what is your favorite sci-fi moment, really, really quick?
I really like when she's talking to Alucard at the end, right after he's done the deed, and she says, you know, you've saved countless lives, but it's okay to mourn the man, too. And just acknowledging Dracula's humanity and what a sacrifice this was for his son. I just think that's a powerful moment, so I like that one.
That is a beautiful moment indeed. Ade, as a human, why do you think Isaac was so devoted to Dracula?
Well, I think because they had similar goals, similar experiences with humans. They were both betrayed by humans, and I think that was their commonality. Which, to speak the greater message, I think, is they saw past each other's differences, and they saw each other for just who they were, and I think that's an amazing thing.
Okay. Oh, boy. We'll just skip this one. Well, just in one sentence, if everyone in the audience suddenly turned into vampires, what would you do? One sentence. Ade.
Say it again?
If everyone in the audience suddenly was actually vampires and rushed the stage, what would you do?
Are you kidding me? I hate horror. I hate all that stuff. I'm out of here.
Okay. Alejandra?
Same. I'm with him.
James?
If you can't beat him, join him.
Graham?
I would just invite them to the guest wing. Yes.
Sam?
Holy water.
Adam?
Holy water.
Okay, I'm done. Come get me.
All right, aside from the video game series, are there any other movies or shows that are influenced on this production?
Yeah, because, as I said, not having played the games and having therefore just grifted my way into this gig, once I started doing the reading and the research, I realized how close the setting and themes were to the Hammer horror movies I grew up with. Yeah, many of which were set in Eastern Europe, most of which featured vampires. So at some point I realized that I was just writing a Hammer horror movie for myself.
All right, here it is, the clip. And now we can calm down after this. Woo! Now you can see it. Now you can see it. Can we please, do not film this. Please be respectful of the people who made this wonderful show. Please have the lights down. We got them down. No, put them down. You had it right. Down. Put the lights down, please. And now enjoy a season 3 teaser. Okay, it looks like we're getting the last question, please, sign. So, okay, message received. Last question. If we could just go back to the slides, I will know the last question. Oh, it's on up there. Okay. Sam Dietz, my mom loves old horror movies, but she said this was way too gory and it grossed her out. Your response?
I kind of felt like we didn't have enough in season 2, to be honest. Sorry.
Hey, Mom.
Okay, I guess everybody, you want to stand up and we'll take a bow, or at least wave goodbye to everyone and get close. This is the big photo op moment. Please get a little closer and why don't you hold hands like in the stage plays. Oh, here we go. On three, take your bow. 1, 2, 3.
The world is a vampire.
And that is our panel. Thank you so much for coming. Thank you, guests. Thank you so much. Everybody, please watch the next season.